Good morning, everyone. Let's find a place to sit. We're going to start out as our prelude. We're going to sing page 98, "To God Be the Glory." All the verses. Page 98.
Thank you. a blessing to have you here. I pray that each and every one feels God's presence, knowing that we've been all made in the image of God, and God desires a relationship with us that is real, that is personal, and God has always loved you and always will, and what a blessing that is. And I forgot to say my name. My name is Dennis Carter. I'm pastor here at First United Methodist Church and also at Kannapolis Methodist Church. And it's just a blessing to be here. And at this time, are there any announcements?
I feel like Deb. I'm going to pass the summer lunches schedule again, and there's still a few spots to fill in, but I'm going to start back here and have it go that direction this time. So, thank you.
Just real briefly, I need to meet with the trustees after services, please, real quick. Thank you.
We thank the Lord for the rain.
Oh, yes, what a blessing.
The cancer walk started out well, and then it ran for a little while, but then the rain put it out. But I think that everything went well out there. I didn't stay, of course, but I left before the rain. But we thank everybody for helping out in that cancer fund.
Okay. All right, thank you. Also, I have a thank you note for Ellsworth Methodist Women and her church family. Thank you all so much for the beautiful baby clothes, the baby cross plaque. Is that right? We feel so welcomed and loved by everyone in the church. We thank God every day for direction, for directing us to this church family. And that was Craig and Kayla. And thank you again for that. That's wonderful. Are there any others? Are there any others? I think. All right.
Thank you, Klein, for the donuts and coffee from the Sunday school class.
Yeah, the others. Karen brought all the donuts, by the way. We need to give her credit. So.
Thank you, Karen.
Just wanted to point out and note that this last Tuesday, the leadership team meeting met. We are in the process of doing all the paperwork associated with disaffiliating and reaffiliating. We do not do a whole bunch of announcements about that, not because we're trying to hide it. There's certainly the minutes are available if you want to see them. But ultimately, our church has a vision and a mission to go out and make disciples, and that's what we're working on. And so we don't spend a lot of time announcing all the details of this form being filled out and this thing being filled out. But if you have questions, more than willing to talk with it, have the information available for you. But we're still a congregation out serving God and serving the people. So that's our focus. Thank you.
And last Sunday, I had a text from Karen Rice Ratzliff, or DS, and just thanked us for her service and letting us know that she'll be continually praying for us. And just want to lift that up to you all. And that was a blessing, too. Are there any others? Oh, we got one. I always love it when a little child's hand goes up and I get to watch the parents' faces.
I'm happy that that God helped my grandma feel better.
Yeah, we are happy that God helped your grandmother get better too. Thank you. And she was here last week. That was such a blessing. All right, thank you. Okay. Are there any other announcements? Well, if not, let us send ourselves before the Lord, and then we'll greet one another. Gracious God, we just thank you for loving us. Dear Lord, as we hear a small child, thank you for your healing hand. We're reminded, dear Lord, your healing hand is for all of us. Whether it's whatever situation we're going through, dear Lord, whether it's relationally, physically, mentally, emotionally, and also spiritually, of your forgiveness. We just thank you again. Just continually to work in each and every one of our hearts, and that we would show that love and grace that we have received from you, that we would show to all. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen. So let's take a little time and greet one another, if you would, please.
Please join me in the call to worship. I got it. The Lord be with you. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the steadfast love of the Lord. He gathered the waters of the sea as in a bottle. He put the deeps in storehouses.
Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him.
Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we are in awe of you. How you created all things. How you love us. How you care for us. Dear Lord, how you have made a way that we are forgiven. We thank you and praise you for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We also thank you that you tell us to come to you, bring our prayers to you, because you care. Gracious God, we just thank you again. We thank you for the moisture that we received. We thank you for VBS, dear Lord, this past week. We thank you, for this weekend, for Friday, dear Lord, for all those that participated, all those that helped out. When we think of the walk, dear Lord, the cancer walk, I just thank you again for loving us. I thank you again, dear Lord, as one shared about her grandmother, about your healing touch. Dear Lord, I just pray that you just continually to work in each and every heart. Dear Lord, restore us to you. To restore us with others. We thank you again for your love and grace. We thank you again for this opportunity. Dear Lord, I thank you for this church family, that we would just continually to reach out to a world where many may even find you as a stranger, that we would show that love and grace that we have received from you, that we would share with them, that we would share the hope that we have in our Lord and Savior. We thank you again for all of these things. Now, gracious God, we come to you in a prayer that Jesus taught the disciples. As we say together,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now at this time, we'll be singing the hymn, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise, found in hymn number 103 or up on the screen. If you're comfortable standing, would you please stand as we sing our hymn. I think the children are going to come and help. Okay. Lisa will talk and Deb will help the kids with the basket.
Yeah, and I want to let you know how Deb works. She said, you do it this time, I'll do it next month. Well, next month we have a speaker. So anyway, in your bulletin, you have an insert. Today we're doing Ellsworth Family Connection, and on your insert is a little bit of their history that I took off of their webpage, but also some of the facts about them is that they are a 501c3 organization. Some of the services they include are overnight accommodations, which they allow up to 7 days lodging under special circumstances, they said. They provide information and referrals for the families, and they also are connected with the Ellsworth Correctional Facility. They have some opportunities for us, and we can be volunteers, and of course we can contribute supplies, and we can also contribute money. And the donations, money-wise, it goes to the utilities, the supplies that are needed for personal and cleaning, etc. And they also apparently have one employee that they pay. Some of the items that are needed are Kleenex, you know, like your toiletries, the paper towels, the bathroom tissue, laundry detergent, paper plates, bottled water. They even say bath towels, sheets, comforters, and that type of stuff. So, and I think in Sunday School, Rose said that in the last, since January, this church has donated $1,000 towards the Family Connection. So thank you for doing that.
Thank you all so much for your prayers and for your help for Family Connections. At this time, we'll have a special VBS Bible school songs, okay?
Okay, anybody who's involved in Bible school, come on up. You kids and Evelyn, thank you for all the help and prayers and everything. Let's make sure, come up in here. Rosemary was our church representative for Bible school, and of course she had her back surgery this week, so we get to tell you a little bit about what happened. Some of you may know, but we had 120 kids. That was kind of the average amount of kids from kindergarten to through fourth grade. We had 34 adult helpers and 37 youth helpers, so we were very happy for all of those. We had a great, great time. We learned a lot of stuff. Our theme was stellar, and we were talking about outer space and all how God shines his light even through space. And some of our themes, we've got them up here all around, so I hope you can take the time and look at them. It was just pretty fun. Every day had a different theme. But when life gets dark,
shine Jesus' light.
And we talked about how the world was dark and Jesus came as a baby. Then the second day, when people don't get along,
shine Jesus' light.
That was the story of Zacchaeus. On the third day, when good things happen,
shine Jesus' light.
And that was the story of Jesus riding on the donkey in Jerusalem with the parade. And everybody was happy for a while. And then when people are sad,
shine Jesus' light.
That's right. That was the story of the crucifixion and Jesus raising from the dead. So even when the world is all around us, people are sad, we know that there is another ending to the story. Then finally on Friday, when people need help,
shine Jesus' light.
And we talked about Philip and the Ethiopian and how God was allowed Philip to shine Jesus' light in his life, and then he went and spread the light to others. Our music was high energy. The games, we didn't have any water this year, so we didn't get wet. Okay, but they were still fun. Our snacks were awesome. The kid video, a lot of the kids liked that part of it. They had a video that it related everyday life to our Bible story and what our theme was. So that was pretty fun. Imagination Station, we did experiments. Not everything blew up like it was supposed to, but we tried. And then, of course, we had Bible Discovery, and that was Bible stories, and we have some posters for those. Everything, the theme tied together, and it was just really, really fun. Something different. We haven't done a space one before. So we would like to share a couple of our songs with you today. The first one is our theme song called Shine His Light. And if you'll notice by the actions, we have a lot of light. So we did a lot of this all week long. And anytime we say the world, we go in a circle. So we'll have to spread out a little so we don't run into each other. Okay, let's see if we can go. Shine His Light.
going to share with you all. So the young disciples can stay here, and Jason's going to come and share.
All right, you guys did a good job singing, and it sounds like you learned a lot this week about what? What was the theme? Space? Stellar? Shine Jesus light. So what is stellar? Do you know what stellar means? Hayden?
Cool.
It's nice, cool, right? Stellar literally means the stars, right? So you guys had a space theme. So I got a ball here.
For what, Papa?
I don't know. Well, let's look at this ball. It's my ball. Okay, you can hold the ball. What does this ball remind you guys of? A star. Why does it remind you of a star? It's pretty bright, right? What color is this?
Yellow.
What else reminds you of something that's yellow and bright? Not right now. The sun. Good. It is the sun, right? And did you know that the sun is a star? Did you know that? You did? You learned that at school already? All right. So what do we know about the sun? Does it move a lot? Yeah, does the sun move around the earth?
No.
The earth moves around the sun, right? So in stellar, when you have that big ball of light, ball of fire, did you know that if the earth was too close to it, it would burn it up? And if it's too far from it, it would freeze up? So we are perfectly at the right spot. Perfectly at the right spot so that we can live on the earth. Like, if you think of that, let me see. If you think of that as the sun, the earth is like this big. See how big that is? Can you compare that with the big old sun? Right. So if you have that tiny little earth, if you get it close to the sun, put it here. If you put this too close to the sun, it'd burn it straight up. God is kind of like that. In that, God is this big, and we are about here, right? But God always allows us to live just right, and He doesn't change. We can go around Him. He will never change. In your life, you'll be sad, you'll be happy, you'll be angry, but God will always be the same. Okay? Let's pray. Thank you, God, for this morning that you've given us. Thank you for never changing and always having us in your mind. Help us to grow closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, go get your snacks.
This time we'll be singing the hymn, the Servant Song, that's found in the Faith We Sing, number 2222, four twos, 2222, the Servant Song. We're up on the screen.
Thank you.
this time, I'll have the ushers come forward as we have prayer, as we receive our offering. Would the ushers please come forward? Let us pray. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we come before you today. We thank you, knowing that all good things come from heaven above. We come to you to be in ministry with you. We ask that you bless this offering we're about to receive, that it further your kingdom here in Ellsworth and throughout the world, that people would hear the good news of Jesus Christ, of his life, death, and resurrection, that we serve a risen Lord that has defeated both sin and death and is now seated at the right hand of the Father Almighty. Dear Lord, not only we ask that you bless this offering, but gracious God, I ask that you bless each and every one that can hear my word. Bless those that are able to give financially of time, service, prayers, and their presence. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen.
Scripture this morning is found in the book of John, chapter 13, 12 through 17, and also Matthew, chapter 5, 38 to 40. That's on pages 131 and page 6, respectively. After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." You have heard that it was said, "An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth." But I say to you, Do not resist an evildoer, but if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your coat, give your cloak as well. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Actually, I wanted to go to verses 42. I think I didn't get that put in, even though I had that in my mind. And anyway, you'll get to hear another couple of verses to finish out that paragraph. But at this time, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, you understand us, you get us. Dear Jesus, from the Sermon on the Mount, you shared with us about the eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. And you showed us in John 13 by washing the feet of the disciples. So I just ask humbly that you would give me the words today, that they'd be your words and not mine, that we'd have a greater understanding and interpretation of your words for our lives. We just thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen. You know, as Christians, we believe that Jesus lived a perfect life. For others, that's hard to believe, that Jesus lived a perfect life. He was faultless, he was blameless, he did not sin. Jesus set a very high bar for himself and for others. He taught, love your enemy. Forgive those who intentionally wrong you. And this is easy in theory, but very tough to practice. Very tough to practice. You know, it kind of reminds me of that great theologian from the state of Missouri. Mark Twain once said, "When I read the Bible, the things that don't bother me is the things I don't understand, but what really bothers me is the things that I understand." It must not have been very easy for Jesus to practice what he preached. When he was mocked, surely he was tempted to belittle his persecutors when he was mocked. Haven't you felt that way when someone makes fun of you and mocks you? Don't you want to maybe reply back? Man, you guys are all saints. I guess this sermon's just for me. But you're going to have to listen to it anyway, all right? When he was betrayed by a close friend, he could have berated him publicly, but he didn't. Ultimately, when he was even being crucified, he didn't condemn his accusers or executioners. What did he do? He forgave them. He forgave them. Can you imagine being the executors and driving that 6-inch spike through his wrist? And Jesus saying, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." We know that even one of the thieves on the cross had a change of heart. He was even mocking Jesus. But before he died on the cross, he realized that he was the Messiah. He was the King. And even a Roman centurion even said, "This must be the Son." When we realize how hard it must have been, even for Jesus, where he recognized that he faced similar pressures to be a good example that we do today. He understands us. He gets us. It's tough to always set the right example for our kids, for our friends, for our neighbors, isn't it? Fortunately, there are many trying hard to do a great job at it. And we acknowledge the challenge and struggle it is to always be on your best behavior. It reminds me of a story that they used to tell in Kentucky at Asbury Seminary about a father with his, probably his six-year-old daughter. His crops, his corn, didn't do as well as his neighbors. And he told his daughter, I'm going to go in this other field, I'm going to pick corn for a family. But if you see anyone or anyone watching me, please come and tell me. She said, okay, Daddy. So he took that bushel basket and he was pulling the ears off of the corn. And she came running, Daddy, Daddy, someone is watching you. And he stopped and he looked out, poked his head out from the rows of corn. He says, there's no one here. Go back to the end and let me finish what I'm doing. And he's starting to pull ears off the corn again. And the little girl comes running, Daddy, Daddy, someone sees you. Someone is watching you. And so he went and looked again. He said, honey, there's no one. Go back at the end of the field. I still have a little bit more to pick. So he gets started again, and she runs, Daddy, Daddy, someone's watching you. And he says, honey, there's no one watching me. And she's crying. He says, Daddy, I'm watching you. I'm watching you. In Matthew chapter 5, verses 38 through 42, I'm going to read this to you since I cut the last couple of verses. For you have heard that it is said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist the evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. When we look at Matthew 5, chapter 5, verses 38 through 42, this comes from the Sermon on the Mount. An eye for an eye. The law did establish this standard as a principle for limiting retribution to that which was just. We see that in Exodus 21:24, Leviticus 24:20, and Deuteronomy 19:21. Its design was to ensure the punishment in civil cases fit the crime. But then again, have you ever heard anyone says, I don't get mad, I get even? No, they don't want to get even. They want to get ahead, right? They even want to do worse to someone than what they had received. And it was never meant to sanction acts of personal retaliation. So again, Jesus made no alteration to the true meaning of the law. He was merely explaining and affirming the law's true meaning. In verse 39, not to resist an evil person. Like verse 38, this deals with only matters of personal retaliation, not criminal offenses or acts of military aggression. Jesus applied this principle of non-retaliation to affront against one's dignity. Like in verse 39, a slap on the face. This was to humiliate you. It was very much the same thing as spitting in someone's face. And Jesus said, if they slapped you on the right side, it would have been backhanded to turn the other cheek. and lawsuits to gain one's personal assets. If they take your shirt, give them your coat, give them your cloak. To keep one even warm, Jesus said, let them take it. Let them take it. In the infringement of one's liberty, in verse 41, to walk that second mile. See, the Roman soldiers, by decree, if they saw you, they could take off their backpack and make you carry it 1 mile. And Jesus says, no, don't retaliate. Not only go 1 mile, but go 2. And then the violations of property rights. Jesus was calling for a full surrender of all personal rights. He was saying, if you surrender, they'll see that what your focus truly is. And that's exactly what Jesus did. No, it wasn't easy. He was human. He was human. Like I said in verse 41, when it says compels, the word speaks of coercion or force. They coerced it or they forced them. The New Testament picture is the Roman soldiers were compelled. Simon the Cyrene to carry Jesus' cross. Can you imagine carrying that 75 to 120 pound cross? Being next to Jesus as he was beyond recognition, as he was bleeding. And then verse 42, Jesus is not advocating that believers give to the point where they can no longer meet their own obligations, but rather he teaches that the heart of a genuine Christian is always open to the needs of others. This teaching complements Paul's statement about not caring for one's household in 1 Timothy 5:8, that we should take care of our own household. When I look at the writings from Max Lucado, aside from the location and time, our story is the same as the disciples. We weren't in Jerusalem and we weren't alive that night that Jesus washed the feet of his fellow followers. But what Jesus did for them, he is still doing today. He is still cleansing hearts from sin. John told us we are being cleansed from every sin by the blood of Jesus. In other words, we are always being cleansed. The cleansing is not a promise for the future, but a reality in this very present day. Let a speck of dust fall on the soul of a saint, and it is washed away. Let a spot of filth land in the heart of God's child, and the filth is wiped away. Jesus still cleans his disciples' feet. Jesus still washes away stains. Jesus still purifies his people. Our Savior kneels down and gazes upon the darkest acts of our lives. But rather than recoil in horror, he reaches out in kindness and says, I can clean that if you want. And from the basin of his grace, he scoops a palm full of mercy and washes away our sin. But that is not all he does. Because he lives in us, you and I can do the same. Because he has forgiven us, we can forgive others. Because he has a forgiving heart, we can have a forgiving heart. We can have a heart like his. In John 13, 14 and 15, now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. You should as do as I have done for you. Jesus washes our feet for two reasons. The first is to give us mercy. The first is to give us mercy. And the second is to give us a message. That message is simply is this. Jesus offers unconditional grace. And we are to offer unconditional grace. The mercy of Christ precedes our sin. Our mercy precedes the mistake and sins of others. Those in the circle of Christ had no doubt of his love. And those in our circles should have no doubt of our love for them. What does it mean to have a heart like his? It means to kneel as Jesus knelt. Touching the grimy parts of people we are stuck with and washing away their unkindness with kindness. We see that in Matthew 5, 38 through 42, and also in John 13, 1 through 17. He was washing the feet of one that was going to betray him. He was washing the feet of one that was going to deny him three times, even though he told him he would. He said, "Oh, no, not I. Maybe the rest of them, but not I," said Peter. And also washing the feet of all those that scattered. They scattered. They hid. But as it tells us in John 13:1, he loved them to the end. And we are to love one another. We are to care for one another. As Paul wrote, be kind and loving to each other and forgive each other just as God forgave you in Christ. Ephesians 4, verse 32. Forgive as Christ has forgiven you. The greatness or the genius of Jesus' example is this. The burden of the bridge falls on the strong one, not on the weak one. The one who is innocent is the one who makes the gesture. Jesus was without sin. He got up, took his outer garment off, and put on that rib. He took the basin. He took the water. He took the towel. And you know what happens when we make that gesture? More often than not, if the one in the right volunteers to wash the feet of the one in the wrong, both parties get on their knees. Don't we all think we're right? Hence we wash each other's. Please understand, relationships don't thrive because the guilty are punished, but because the forgiven are merciful. Because we have been forgiven, that we are merciful, that we are loving, that we are forgiving, that we are caring. What a difference it makes. What a difference it makes. I've had the opportunity to go to Ellsworth Correctional Facility, go to the prison, and be there for 2 to 3 days at a time. And to tell those men that no matter what sin they have committed, that Jesus' grace is greater than all sin. That if they want to, if they desire to repent, to turn back to God and ask forgiveness, he will give it. You know, when those disciples received that, at first they didn't understand. And then Jesus was arrested, they scattered, and he was crucified. They were even hiding in the upper room with the door locked. But the risen Lord came and visited them. with them for 40 days before he ascended into heaven. Yes, Jesus felt the pressure to be a good role model. We know this because he was also human too. He was fully human and fully divine. He knew what it was to even have his own siblings think that he was less than what he actually was. He knew what it was to be betrayed. He knew what it was to be denied. He knew what it was to be lied against. But he forgave. And as his followers, we are to forgive. He can relate to the pressure that we put on ourselves and the side he places on our shoulders, because he gets us. He understands us. And you're never alone. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. Let us pray. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, when I think how they hurled insults at you, dear Jesus, you didn't retaliate, but you looked at them with love. You did this for all of us. You died on that cross for all of us. The one that was sinless, the one that was blameless. And just the day before that, you washed their feet of the disciples. And you told them to do likewise. So, dear Lord, we thank you again that you get us, that you understand us. And because we have your heart, because we have accepted you as Jesus, as our Lord and Savior, that we would forgive because we have been forgiven, that we would show grace and mercy because we have received grace and mercy. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. So at this time, if you're comfortable standing, I'm going to ask if you would please stand as we sing our final hymn, Be Thou My Vision, number 451, 451, Be Thou My Vision. Show that same love, that same grace. grace, that same mercy that we have received from you, that we would show to others, and that they'd have a greater understanding of your love, of your forgiveness. So I send them out in your power, dear Lord. Send them out in the power of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. God bless you all.